Good morning and welcome to this video service. Even though, as you know, our church buildings are closed, and that's hugely sad, with public worship suspended, and we're all doing our very best to keep safe and to live safely with consideration for others. That's what we've got to do, isn't it, at this time of the coronavirus. Even though the churches are closed, God isn't closed down at all, and never can be. God is always open to our prayers and delighted that we want to come close to him. So let's begin, as we do in worship, by coming close to God in prayer. Today is Passion Sunday. We're two Sundays off Easter Sunday, and we remember on Passion Sunday Jesus suffering for us as a victim of the violence of humankind. So let's pause for a moment and pray. Christ, our victim, whose beauty was transfigured and whose body torn upon the cross, open wide your arms to embrace our tortured world, particularly as we agonise with the coronavirus, so that we may not turn away our eyes, but continue to seek your face, that we may see you in the poor and broken, the homeless and despairing, and even in each other. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 1 to 5. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. This is the word of the Lord.
The Gospel reading is taken from John chapter 12, verses 20 to 33. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now in the judgment of this world, now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the word of the Lord.
In John's Gospel, chapter 12, which I think Ronalyn's reading for us today, some Greeks say to Philip, "Sir, we would see Jesus." And so we would, wouldn't we? We want to see Jesus. But the face of Jesus is not always a pretty sight. I've brought a picture with me. This is the suffering servant of God spoken about by the prophet Isaiah in chapter 53, the one who was despised and rejected. This is from Coventry Cathedral. The sculpture of the crucified Jesus in this picture that we're looking at was made from the metal of a crashed motor car. It's a poignant reminder that the daily crucifixions of man by man in careless driving, like those in war, can only be redeemed by love. But it's easy for me to say that. A few weeks ago, I heard a 93-year-old German theologian visiting here. He was up in London, Jürgen Moltmann, speaking about the question, how can one talk of God after the horrors of Auschwitz? You're aware that only a few weeks ago we were marking the anniversary of the liberation of that death camp at Auschwitz. How can one talk of God after the horrors of Auschwitz? Moltmann said, and he quoted Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the German pastor who was executed for being part of a plot to get rid of Hitler. Bonhoeffer had seen the horror of what was happening in the death camps, and he wrote, as he reflected on the horror, "Only a suffering God can help. Only a suffering God can help." Moltmann had himself been to Auschwitz after the war had ended, and he asked himself as he visited that dreadful place, where is this suffering God? And after returning from the camp, he wrote his book, The Crucified God. Here we are, this book, total classic in theological terms. He wrote this in an attempt to wrestle with the question, in an attempt to make some sense of that dreadful experience. We come back to the request of the Greeks to Philip. Sir, we would see Jesus. Well, if you want to see Jesus, look at the death camps. Look at those whose lives are being turned upside down, even at this moment, with the coronavirus. If you want to see Jesus, look at the man hanging on the cross. Is God himself a victim? Moltmann urged us to ask. Does God die in the innocent children and the others? He suggested that we have to endure the unending suffering of God, because there's a kind of equation. If God cannot suffer, God cannot love. The two go together, don't they? So we see God's love poured out for us on the cross. John's Gospel shows us the love of God focused as never before in the man hanging on the cross. And although this expresses God's love for each one of us individually, and that is so, this is not just personal and subjective. It forces us to an examination of the attitudes and prejudices that dominate and mess up our society. For example, to whom, we might ask ourselves, are we indifferent, terminally indifferent? Sir, we would see Jesus. That was the question. We would see him in others, in ourselves, in the suffering and needy, and in the broken structures of our society. We stand aghast with Maltmann and Bonhoeffer, and all of us who are wanting to see Jesus in each other. We are left without words at the foot of the cross. Let me end with this reflection in verse. Countless Jews transported by despotic hate to the cruel camps where they will meet their fate. Where was their God then? What words can explain? Does their God still love them? Who will share the pain? Countless victims swallowed by the raging tide through the spreading virus, futures are denied. Where was their God then? What words can explain? Does their God still love them? Who will share the pain? Single victim hanging high upon the tree, Jesus, by his suffering, dies to set us free. There is our God now, showing to make plain that our God still loves us and will share our pain. The shadow of the cross in which we travel during Lent is cast by the light of the resurrection behind it. There is hope. God can be trusted. Jesus said, "When I am lifted up from the earth on the cross, I shall draw all humanity to myself."
Let us pray to God, who alone makes us dwell in safety, for all who are affected by coronavirus through illness or isolation or anxiety, that they may find relief and recovery. For those who are guiding our nation at this time and shaping our national policies, that they may make wise decisions. For doctors, nurses, and medical researchers, that through their skill and insights, many will be restored to health. For the isolated and housebound, that we may be alert to their needs and care for them in their vulnerability. For our homes and families, our schools and young people, and for all in any kind of need or distress. For a blessing on our local community, that our neighbourhoods may be places of trust and friendship, where all are known and cared for. For the vulnerable and the fearful, for the gravely ill and the dying, that they may know your comfort and peace. For the health and well-being of our nation, that all who are fearful and anxious may be at peace and free from worry. Within our own town centre parish, we pray for Carol Fidler, Elizabeth Bennett, Isabel Bell, Isabel Crossley, Margaret Shillabeer, Rosemary Miles, Susan Haynes, Val Spence, and Vanielle Correju. We commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's draw this service to a close by asking a word of blessing from God. May the God who dies on the cross, whom death could not contain, who lives to disturb and heal us, cherish you and all your loved ones in his arms of love, and bless you richly, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.